Is it true that you are thinking of me? How you love me? It's amazing. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Who am I that you are mindful of me? That you hear me when I call. And is it true that you are thinking of me? How you love me. It's amazing. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. I am a friend of God. God Almighty, Lord of glory, you have come to be friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Friend of God, I am a friend of God, he calls me friend. I am a friend of God, I am a friend of God, I am a friend of God, he calls me friend. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend.
Amen.
Amen.
That song, sorry. That song was Wim Darnley's favorite song. My stepfather. Always makes me think of him, but if you think about it, that I'm a friend of God, how powerful that is, that God actually called us friends. And there's one thing that I can say, that he was a friend of God. Eh? Still miss him. Yeah. Morning, everyone.
Morning.
Yeah. Well, I don't know, Jaya, what do you say? Should we have church today?
I think so.
Should we? Okay.
I think it's done.
Let's have church. With two or three gather, there I am. Amen.
Amen.
Just remind you about all the cell groups quickly. So on a Tuesday night, 7 o'clock, Royer Scroll, we have that.
Yeah.
We have ladies meeting.
Thursday morning, 10 o'clock on Zoom.
Yeah, 7 o'clock in Kempton Park, Red Marais, by me. Yeah.
Good. That's it.
Anyone we can sing for, birthdays, anything?
Any birthdays?
No.
No anniversaries, no birthdays. Sure.
Where's all your friends? Hmm? No?
Good question.
Yes.
Oh. Yeah, that's why it. Not?
Nah, we're singing for you.
Morgie, come up here.
You'll have to come, yeah, though. No, you have to come, yeah, we put you on the camera. Otherwise, people doesn't know what we're talking about. No, they won't. They can't hear you from there.
Yeah, to all those watching on Facebook, on YouTube.
We won't tell them that it's
Rainbow Gospel Radio. If you're watching, I hope Kurbis can get the camera shot on Morgie.
Not that one?
No. No, not that one.
Okay, let's see.
Yes, we love you with the love of the Lord. Yes, we love you with the love of the Lord. For we see in you the glory of our King. And we love you with the love of the Lord. Yes, we bless you with the blessings of the Lord. Yes, we bless you with the blessings of the Lord. For we see in you the glory of our King. And we bless you with the blessings of the Lord.
Amen.
We're going to go into worship. Bow your heads. Father God, mighty King, we honor you. We praise you. We want to come into you, your worship now, Lord. We want to worship to you. I ask that you remove everything in this place, everything on anyone that is not of you. Holy Spirit, I pray that you go and fill that gap. Holy Spirit, I ask you to come in here, to lead us, to teach us, to guide us, and take over in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He! And together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord. Down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He! And together we say, everyone say, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. It's rising up. Lord, tonight. It's the end, my, the Lord tonight. And together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord.
Every breath that I am able,
the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. Faith can move the mountains, let the mountains move. We've come with expectation, waiting here for you. Waiting. still you know my heart, the author of salvation. You loved me from the start. I'm waiting here for you with our hands lifted high in praise. And it's you we adore, singing hallelujah. Faithfulness is true. We are desperate for your presence. All we need is you. Waiting here for you with our hands lifted. Hunger and thirst. Speak to me now. Speak to me now. I surrender. I surrender. I want to know you more. I want to know you more. I surrender. I surrender. I want to know you more. I want to know.
Back? Yes, there we go. Thank you. Good morning. I thank you all for being here, and thanks for Thursday morning, those who attended. Yeah, it was a good morning. Zander, to you for your father-in-law passing away, then from us, our heartfelt condolences to you. Also to Annalene, who lost her grandfather. It is not a good time to go through, but we pray that the Lord also touches their family there. Then I would like to this morning also pray for my uncle. He is in hospital in a critical condition, and I'd also like to pray for him. Is there anyone else that feels this morning that they need prayer? And if you need prayer, just stand up where you are, and I'm going to pray now. So anybody who feels they need prayer today,
if we can just, if they can stand and we can pray, please. Is anybody that needs prayer with me, please? There we go. Thank you. There we go. People are standing all over, and we're going to pray together. Let us pray, and you just close your eyes, and please put up your hands and believe with me. Lord God, I come to you this morning, and I pray that you will touch everyone, that you will bring us back into the time of your presence. I also pray, Lord, that you will be with everyone that needs a touch this morning of your Holy Spirit. And I pray that the Spirit of God will come through and anoint them now. I pray, Lord, for healing as never before. Anyone who needs healing this morning, that God will heal them. And I thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may take your seats. Thank you. It is the prayer of faith that makes us victorious this morning. So, the first thing I want to speak to you about this morning is your job is not done. Have you ever gone to someone and then you tell them the job is finished and they say, no, your job is not done yet. No. What about this and what about that? What is that? I don't know. If you're married, you'd also find that sometimes. Your job is not done. You think your job is done, but it's not. There's something that you've still left out, something that you've still got to do. You can't just walk away from this job. Your job is not done. And that's what I want to speak to you about this morning is I want to tell you that your job is not done. I want you to turn to the last page in your Bible. So it's not difficult to get that one. If you have a Bible this morning, the last page in your Bible, well, okay, the last page of it might be something else, but look at the last page of the Bible specifically, and that's Revelation 22. I want you to page to Revelation 22, the last page, the grand finale of the Bible, and I want you to go and look at verse 11 for me there. So let's go to verse 11. It says, whoever is evil must go on doing evil, and whoever is filthy must go on being filthy. Whoever is good must be doing good, go on doing good, and whoever is holy must go on being holy. And then Jesus says, and he says this to John, he says, listen, says Jesus, I am coming soon. I will bring my rewards with me to give to each according to what he has done. I am the first and the last, the beginning and the end. And then he speaks about the Alpha and the Omega as well. So I just want to bring you Jesus' last call. So Jesus' last written call, except for the verse further down in verse 20 where he says, surely I come quickly. But his last call to the church is this. He says, it's almost a closure already. Then he says, I'm the Alpha and the Omega. He says, I'm the beginning and the end, the first and the last. So in other words, three times God says he was there in the beginning and he will be there through to the end. God will never, Jesus will never go away. So in other words, if we go to 1 John 1, or John 1 verse 1, and I always quote that back to Genesis 1 verse 1 and John 1 verse 1. Go and have a look there. Jesus was at the creation. Jesus was there. He was on call at the creation. Then Jesus comes and takes on a human body on earth. And after that, he ascends to heaven. I was listening to a professor this morning on the radio, and he says Jesus had taken the crown of thorns, and at ascension, He'd exchanged the crown of thorns for the heavenly crown. Isn't that wonderful? Jesus had at the ascension, he'd taken on his kingship in heaven, and he had taken away, the crown of thorns was taken away from him, and he was given the crown of heaven, and he had taken that on. It's a wonderful piece of history that we have, and that we also commemorate in this time. But what I want to bring to you is that he still said, this is the job you have to do. Now let's have a look at Revelation 22 verse 14. He says, happy are those who wash their robes clean, so that they have a right to eat the fruit of the tree of life. Happy are those who wash their robes clean, so they would have the right to eat of the fruit of the tree of life. Remember, the fruit of the tree of life was forbidden in the Garden of Eden. It was forbidden. Now he says, if you wash your robes clean, and that's by the blood of the Lamb, then you have the right to eat of the tree of life. Now that is a great thing, because the tree of life gives you the eternal substance that's there. So you can eat of the tree of life. You are then dedicated to the tree of life by your washing of the blood of Jesus Christ. It's fantastic that God worked it. And then he says, and to go through the gates into the city. But outside the city, there are the perverts and those who practice magic, with immoral and murderers, and who worship idols, and those who are liars, both in words and deeds. And that is a condition. Now, Jesus speaks to those people. He says, those are the people that will not enter heaven. He says, those people will not enter heaven. They will be outside. They will be outcasts. And Jesus says that. Nobody else, but Jesus says this to in his vision to John. Jesus says this to John. So this is the last words that we have of Jesus saying something to somebody in this. And he says that these people will be outside of the kingdom of God. They will be put outside. You see, there's a balance of two, yeah, and that balance of two must come back into the church as well. It's holy versus unholy. There's no difference between, there's no difference, and we can go into all of these fancy ideologies and theologies and all these things, but two words are quite impressive, and those are the balanced words, and that's holy versus unholy. Holy versus unholy. That's what it is. There's no difference between the two at all. In Revelation 22:16, it goes further, and Jesus says, I have sent my angel to announce these things to you in the churches. I am the descendant from the family of David. I am the bright morning star. And the spirit of the bride says, come. The spirit of the bride says, come. Who's the spirit of the bride, by the way? The Holy Spirit, the chaperone. I've spoken about that. And the Holy Spirit of the bride says, come. Everyone who hears this must also say, come. Come, whoever is thirsty, accept the water of life as a gift, whoever wants it, whoever wants it. Now, the main thing here is that anybody, it does not matter who you are, if you want the water of life, it will be given you. Nobody can hold it or withhold it from you, because that is the work of God. And God gives everyone the privilege of taking on the and drinking of the water of life, which comes through Jesus. And there's no other way that you're going to get the water of life but through him. But then he comes, Jesus comes, and this is the call to the church. And firstly, he says, to those who hear, you and I sitting in this church this morning, you and I sitting here who hear the voice of God. God speaks to those who hear. And everyone who hears has the opportunity to accept or reject, to become holy or stay unholy. That is your own prerogative this morning. That has got nothing to do with God. But what has got to do with God, if you open your heart and your mind, God will fill your soul with the living water that will overflow from inside to outside, and you will speak the words of God by the Holy Spirit. That is what God wants of you, and that is what it would be. You see, this water of life, my brother and sister, is special, and it's for thirsty people. It's always there for the thirsty. The water of life is there for thirsty people. The people that are quenched already, and quenched by their own sin, and quenched by their own perverseness, so quenched by everything that they believe is right, those people will probably not want to drink of the water of life, because they are not thirsty for it. But when you get into a position where you're in a corner, my brother and sister, and most people that are in a corner drink of the water of life, And then they come to repentance, they come to know Jesus, and once they've repented and come to know Jesus, their life changes, and they are inculcated with the water of life. Everything about them, and your whole body is actually moisture anyway. But then, sister, and this body of yours then contains the water of life, and this water of life energizes you, and it makes you to be what God wants you to be. See, the call for acceptance this morning from Jesus is that the church should again accept the water of life and take the water of life to people, because what we're doing now is we're sharing our prosperity. We're sharing the good things with one another. But the real carnal change in lives is when I come to know the Lord Jesus Christ, I will change from what I was to what I am. And what I'm going to be in Christ, not that I would stay the same old person. Because if I just stay the same old person, well then, what is the use of the water of life? What is the use of the covering of the blood? What is the use of the cleansing of the blood if I'm not cleansed from anything? A cleansing takes place, and after the cleansing, I stay cleansed. And if I'm not cleansed, then I need to go back to the throne and be cleansed. But cleansing is a daily opportunity through the water of life. That's what God calls us for. There's a condition, though. Whosoever wants it, whoever wants it, will get it. Whoever wants it. Now the question is, do you want it this morning? Do you want to do that this morning? And do you want to take on the water of life this morning? But then Jesus comes and just before he ascends into heaven, he speaks to Peter. And listen to this, and I want to bring this to you, and this is where the job that we have to do has to be done. John 21 verse 15 says, "And after they had eaten, Jesus said to Simon Peter, 'Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these others do?' And he says," remember, Jesus, Peter was the one that betrayed Jesus, but now Jesus is speaking to him again. And Jesus loved him, and Peter did great works after that, because Peter also gave the first sermon of the new church. And we will commemorate that next Sunday, where the Holy Spirit came over the church. And it was in the morning, by the way. It wasn't even in the evening like people think. It was in the morning. But in that time, just before this, and just before the ascension, Jesus says, Simon, son of John, he actually gives the full relay of his name and where he came from. He doesn't just say Peter. He says, "Simon, son of John." Peter, Simon, son of John. Because he brings him his history and he brings it all to him. Jesus is formalizing this. And he says, "Do you love me more than these others do?" The other people here. And he says, "Yes, Lord." And he answered, "You know I love you." Jesus said to him, "Take care of my lambs." He gives him a command. He says, remember before he betrays him once. Jesus repairs the betrayal with the living water. Isn't that wonderful? The first time of the three times. Look at the three times now. So the first time he betrays Jesus. And now Jesus comes and repairs that one time. He says to him, "Take care of my lambs." Gives him a job to do. A second time Jesus said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He says, "Yes, Lord." And he answers, "You know that I love you." And Jesus said to him, "Take care of my sheep." Second command. Take care of my sheep. Two betrayals canceled. Two of Peter's betrayals canceled. "Take care of my sheep. I'm giving you a job to do. You betrayed me once. You betrayed me twice. But now I'm giving you a job to do." And then a third time cancels the betrayal of Peter. Isn't God wonderful? Isn't Jesus wonderful? He cancels the betrayal, the three betrayals of Peter. He cancels with three commands. And he says a third time, and Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And Peter came and said, now he's sad. And sometimes when we get saddened like that, it reminds us of how bad we were. We saddened on the way bad we were. But Jesus comes and he repairs it with the water of life, and he gives him a job to do. And he says, so he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. And Jesus said to him a third time, take care of my sheep. In this time this morning, I'm saying that God's called you to take care of his sheep, my brother and sister. And you might have betrayed God so many times. You might have hurt God so many times. But all God says to you this morning is, take care of my lambs. And then he says, take care of my sheep. The job you've got to do this morning. What is the church's job this morning? The church's job, my brother and sister, is to give people access to the living water. The church's job this morning is to give people access to the living water. And last night I was staying at a sick bed again, and I just said, you know what? I said, Roger, the Lord Jesus loves you. He loves you and he's your Savior. And you know what I'm saying to you, brother and sister? I'm saying this morning again. The church needs to get back to the message where Jesus loves you and he's the Savior, and he will save you from all your sin, and he will redeem you, and he will bring you back up. Now, what age group do we link this to? My brother and sister, you know what? I've seen these little ones, they are short and as small as this, and they would take the Bible, and then you see the videos where parents, and I know I've experienced this, where the little one preaches the Word of God as if it's the father or mother preaching that, and they enjoy it, and they believe it, they believe every word they are preaching. Then we get teenagers, my brother and sister, that walk on the school ground, that act under the power of God, that do miracles. They can because God called them to do that. You see, my brother and sister, it's not about your age this morning. It's about how active you are with the Holy Spirit. It's about how active you are with the living water. And it's about how much living water you have in you. Because the more living water you have in you, the more it will bubble out. And the more it bubbles out, the more people will get it. And the more you will be someone that cannot be contained. And the Holy Spirit in you, my brother and sister, will not be contained either. And you will be able to work. You'll be able to care for sheep. And you'll be able to care for the lambs. And you will see, my brother and sister, I'm speaking to young people as well, all over, doesn't matter where you are. God has called you for a purpose. And your purpose is to feed the lambs. To be a lamb that feeds the lambs with the living water. You can do that. That's teenagers. Above that, my brother and sister, into the youth, into the middle age, and into old age, we don't have any age limit as far as God has called us to do his work. To share the living water is for the baby, it is for the teenager, it is for the adult, the young adult, it is for everyone. Living water is for everyone. God has put it out for everyone. And the church needs to put the places in place so that people can have access to the living water. How much do we proclaim the gospel? In the old days, we used to carry a pocket Bible to school. It used to be here. The Bible used to be here. Yes, that was what it was, actually. In school, in your blazer pocket, you had a Bible. I mean, now people are ashamed to carry the Bible. I'm not. I walk into places with a Bible because I know that it's the Word of God and it should be respected. It is called the Holy Bible. And I will keep respecting it wherever I go, my brother and sister. I will carry it with me where I go. And you need to carry the Bible with you where you go. I'll never forget, years ago I was in Kuwait. And we used to get half an hour to phone a week. So Friday nights I used to phone them. It was 20 minutes about. But anyway, it was 20 minutes to half an hour. So every Friday night we could phone. And then you would pay a couple of dirham for phoning there. And then you would sit in the booth, phone, and have your 20 minutes, and then you go home, and then you've spoken for the week. But in this time, while I was waiting for my friend, because he had his turn, was first to phone, there was this Indian lady that had her Bible on the counter, and I said to her, you know what? I said, your Bible, I see your Bible here. She says, yes. She says, I'm just waiting for you to finish. She says, we've got all night prayer tonight. She says, I'm so fired up. We've got all night prayer. She says, I'm going to walk over the street here. And she says, we're all getting together tonight for all night prayer. But brother and sister, where's the church? Where is the church? You ask for all night prayer. An hour is too much. I can't do an hour anymore. I don't know how to pray for an hour. But brother and sister, the living water is being, the level of the living water in the church is subsiding. It's going down, it's going down. And in actual fact, somebody's reserve lights are going on with the living water already because there is none left. And you'll have to get some. And there's no other filling station than the filling station of the Spirit. Am I speaking to the church this morning? Your job is not done, but you don't have water to give people. My brother and sister, how are you going to do your job if you don't yourself have the living water in you? How if yourself, if you can't pray, yourself, if you're not doing what God wants you to do, how can you feed the sheep? How can you give the other sheep water, my brother and sister? And you are the access point to the living water. And shame on you. How many of us, and shame on us. How many of us have closed the door on salvation on so many thousands of people because our living water level is so, so low that we can't share any with anyone else? How many of you share the gifts that you have, that God gave you, the gifts of the Spirit? How many can share something there? Yes, I'm seeing. Thank you. You can share. But it's that, my brother and sister, that God says to you this morning, feed my sheep. And when you share those gifts, my brother and sister, that is where God wants you to care for people. He wants you to take care of his sheep. He wants you to be a caretaker in the place where God can, has put you to be. Your job is not done. I want you to look at that this morning. You can be in any church. It doesn't matter which one you are in this morning, any congregation, but your job is not done. Your job is not done. You can't walk away from this one because you think your job is done and go to another one. Your job will not be done until Jesus comes. Your job will not be done. There's no retirement in this game, by the way. No retirement. You can retire, but you'll never retire from the Word of God. Take care of my sheep. Look after my lambs. You see, we are in the last church. I do believe that. And maybe you don't. But I do believe that we're living in the last times. And our generation might still go. But I believe that the next generation is going to see the works of the Antichrist. If our generation doesn't see it, the next generation will. Because we're already seeing it, my brother and sister. And he's preparing in all these different ways. He's preparing things and putting things in place to take over this world, but only for 7 years. And that's always what I'm so, I get frustrated in my heart to think that the church has had the opportunity to take hold of everything for 2,000 years. But the church fears the 7 years. Where the church should be victorious over everything and also over those 7 years. It's going to be the 7 year worst years that this world has ever seen. Years of destruction. But we as the last church, we as the last church have given up on the most precious gift of the living water, the water of life. We've given up on that because we're not preaching it anymore. We're not teaching it anymore. And if we are, we're doing it at a very low pace and low rate. God wants us to get back. You see, the last church is not the pastor's job. Even pastors will fall away. The last church is an individual's job. And it's all of us, my brother and sister. It's not one pastor speaking to many. It's many pastoring to many. Did you hear what I'm saying? It's going to be many pastoring to many. That's the church of discipleship. That's what happens. You see, my brother and sister, giving your tithe, you should tithe and you should do that, but that's not good enough. That's not all God wants. God doesn't only want your money. God wants you. It's like going to your wife and giving her a present every day, but after all, she means nothing to you at all, nothing. But you're paying her every day. You're giving her something every day. You're giving her a present. Will that present mean anything to your wife? Absolute, or your spouse? Let me rather say that. It will mean absolutely nothing. It's how you do it. It's how you give it. It's how your intentions are that count. This not caring church, I'm not saying that we are a non-caring church because I believe we're church family, but let's face it, the church has changed. Let's face it, the church has changed. And we can change it to what it should be in this last time. This not understanding church that we live in, my brother and sister, and I'm not talking to Shalom Centurion, I'm talking to the church. I'm talking to the broader community this morning. I'm speaking to everyone that hears this message this morning. The not understanding and not caring church is why other religions are taking over the place of the church. That's why people and charitable organizations are taking the place of the church, because the church used to give. The church used to look after. Now everybody else in society is looking after, but the church has taken the back seat in all of this. Other societies have taken over the work of the church. But I want to say to the church this morning, your job is not done. The job, preaching the word of God, is not yet done. Last but not least is the absence of the church is the biggest problem we have. Instead of finding solutions, the church sits, or members of the church sit on the sidelines and prophesy and tell lies and bring up all kinds of accusations instead of trying to find solutions. They sit and criticize from the sidelines, my brother and sister, where the church is absent at the solution table. Where the actual solution to the problem should be found, the church is absent, but then they want to shout from the sides. All over, you want to shout from the sides and say, this is wrong, that's wrong, but you're not at the table for finding solutions when solutions to be found. And this is for church leaders too, my brother and sister. It's because the church leaders are absent in society that society is going wrong, because they can't bring to the table what they have to bring because they're absent. And the church should not be absent. The church should be seen, because the church's job is not done. The church's job is not done. The church's job is not done. What is the job? Matthew 28:18. We all have that on our placards. When I was ordained, that's the scripture that's on my ordaining placard. It's on there on my certificate. This is the certificate that I've got on my when I was ordained, and it says, Jesus drew near and he says, and he said to them, I have given you all authority in heaven and earth. Now the church, Jesus, the first thing the church, Jesus says to the church, I have given you authority in heaven and on earth. Where's your authority? By which authority are you working? By human authority or by godly authority? God has given you authority on heaven and on earth. That means, you can speak the words if you have the living water inside of you and your level is high, because if you're on a reserve, you won't have enough for yourself. But if your level of the living water is high in you, my brother and sister, you will speak in heaven and heaven will listen and heaven will command on earth. That's the authority that you have. that heaven will command on earth on your word, my brother and sister. That's the authority you have. That's the first thing Jesus says. And after that, he says, in Matthew 28, 19, he says, go then to all peoples everywhere. Leave no one out. He says, everywhere. Leave no one out. It's for all of us. And make my disciples, baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit. He says, baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And then he says, and teach them to obey everything I have commanded you. And then what we do is we take them and we make disciples, but we don't baptize them. We fall short. The second point is, we don't teach them. We take them to salvation, but we don't teach them. The job of the church is not done. And then he says, and then everything I commanded you, everything that God has commanded you, it is there, my brother and sister, in black and white, everything that God has commanded you and I've commanded you, that Christ has commanded, so we need to teach the lambs and the sheep. And then I'll ask, is your job done? And then he says, and then many people say, and we've been through this reiteration after iteration, people have said Jesus is coming. For 2,000 years, people have said Jesus is coming. And after 2,000 years, people say Jesus is not coming because he hasn't come for 2,000 years. My brother and sister, Jesus does say, he says, to the end of the age. He says, I will be with the church, with you, till the end of the age. When's the end of the age? I don't know exactly, but God knows. But I can feel it, I can see it, and I can experience it. So I'm asking the church this morning, my brother and sister, where has discipleship gone? Where has discipleship gone? Because discipleship, my brother and sister, is not being a pastor of 1,000,000 or 1,000 or 160. That is not what discipleship is. Discipleship, my brother and sister, is a constant moving and making of disciples, a constant telling and sharing of the water of life, so that, my brother and sister, the maximum people you have to have around you is 12. There's no more that. And who doesn't have 12 friends? My brother and sister, I've said this before. Who doesn't have 12 friends? If you have to start counting your family and your friends, surely you should have 12. Those 12 are your disciples. And if you have to share, and you have to share consistently, you share the love of God with them, sometime they're going to become disciples. If you don't slap them with the Bible, but share the love of God with them. That's what it is. You see, we lose because we do things the wrong way. The water of life is the water of love. It's love and care. Peter got the command from Jesus. He says, care for my sheep. Care for the lambs. Care for them. That's discipleship. You want to be a successful person in making disciples? Start loving people. Start with that. You see, my brother and sister, Jesus' last call was, before he left earth, he said, go and make disciples. Second point is, he said, baptize them. Why? Because that is symbolic, two things, the grave and the second of the washing of sins. So that's symbolic, the baptism, extremely important that the baptism is there and it gets done. The next thing is to take the person from the new birth, to teach them the lambs, start with the lambs. And then you take the lambs, my brother and sister, and they become sheep. And then you will look after them. You will continue looking after them. You won't stop with the lambs, but lambs must always be there. There must always be lambs. There must always be new ones. And that is a question I also ask is, How many lambs are there? Are we just a structure that just stays stagnant and we don't have new lambs coming in, new people being baptized, new people coming in, giving their hearts to the Lord? And that's discipleship, isn't it? It starts with a lamb. Teaching makes them sheep. Teaching gives them the authority in heaven and on earth. I want you to see something this morning. I want you to take this to heart. That you have, if you have the living water of Christ in you, you have authority in heaven that calls for authority on earth and calls for commands change on earth. So your change will be commanded on earth by the authority of heaven. Your prayer is the strongest tool that you have. Your words spoken to God are stronger than words spoken to me or to anyone around you. Your words spoken to God are the words that will pronounce authority around you. Christ will always be with us through the Holy Spirit. Always. Christ will always be with us through the Holy Spirit. And we need to understand that this morning on how and where you do it. You see, I want to make two calls this morning. The first thing, I want to call those who have not tasted the water of life. Those who have not had the water of life to drink. And for them to understand that God has called you this morning so that you can take on the water of life, so that this water that God has given you will be for you to take into your life, and it's life-changing, and it will cause a life-changing moment. And how do I do that? I take that on through repentance. I have to repent, number one. Once I've repented, and then after that repentance, and I accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior, my life changes. It's a new day. It's a new phase. And it's a new time in my life. Immediately. Welcome. And God is always there for us. God will never forsake us. God will never forsake you from that moment on when you've accepted Him as your Lord and Savior. But then, my brother and sister, to the church this morning and to the broader church and to you, my brother and sister, your job is not done. Your job on earth is not done. Don't try and exit from God's work because your job is not done. And your job will not be done until God calls you home. Your job. And keep on with the good work of the Lord. Make sure that God takes you and instructs you by the Holy Spirit to do your job well. So that we can be a church that can have, at the end of that, can have eternal life and say, Lord, I'd like to hear the word, well done. Well done. Well done. Who wants to hear well done? You want to hear well done this morning, and you are prepared to stand with me and take on the job that God has called you for. This is not an earthly job. This is a heavenly one. But this is one with authority. If you're willing to do that with me this morning, stand. Those who feel, Lord, I've let you down so many times in my life. I want to rededicate my life to you this morning. I want to pray for you as well. But please just stand for me, please, there where you are. And let us pray. Thank you. Thank you. Lord God, I come to you this morning, and there are people this morning that have said, Lord, I've let you down. Like Peter, Lord, I betrayed you so many times. Three times I betrayed you, Lord. But three times the Lord gives him a job to do. Lord, let us take on our spiritual jobs this morning. And thank you that the Spirit opens up things to us and in our mind and in our spirits. And you bring things to us into the Word of God. And I pray, Lord, that we will read the Word, understand the Word of God, but more than that, that we will speak to you, Lord, more than ever, that we will pray in our minds and that we will pray through our spirits and that we will give God glory for everything. In Jesus' name, Lord, I proclaim the church has a job to do. We have a job to do, and we're prepared to do that. In Jesus' name, thank you, Lord. Amen and amen. Thank you. Thank you very much. God bless you. And don't forget to have coffee with us when we finish. Thank you. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning and we want to thank you, Lord. Thank you that we can have this time in your presence, and that we can sit and listen to your word. And Lord, I want to pray that as we go our separate ways now, that you will go with each and every person that is here. Be with them, stand beside them, walk beside them until we meet again. And we pray this in your name. Amen.
Shalom family, I just want to say something to you all.